Hello everyone. A very good afternoon to one and all present in this elite discussion. I am Nitin, a third year student of ECE. I would like to extend a warm welcome to the keynote speaker of the day, Mr. Vibhor Jain, on behalf of IIT NITK. We are delighted to have you with us this afternoon, Vibhor. Going further, I would like to welcome all the students present here. A hearty welcome to one and all. Now, I take this opportunity to introduce Mr. Vibhor Jain to you all. He is a proud alumnus of our very own institute, making our chests brim with pride with the accomplishments he has had. He has interned with Texas Instruments and was a part of IEEE Diode SIG. Mr. Jain joined Texas Instruments as an analog engineer in the year 2019. We are honored to have you, Vibhor. Now, I request you to share your journey from NITK to Texas Instruments. Let's hear from the man himself. Over to Mr. Vibhor Jain.
Thank you for such a nice introduction, Nitin.
Thank you.
So, good afternoon all. So one of the things is I didn't tell all my achievements because that would increase the introduction of the speaker, and yeah, I would effectively get less time to talk about my journey. So just a hack for everyone, you know, don't let out your cards in the beginning. Anyway, so yeah, I think I'll start right from the beginning, that is in first year. So one of the things is that I would like to preface this talk is that I was into electronics from, you know, the very beginning. In 11th standard, I think I would have made my mind that it had to be ENC. So finally, during counseling, right, I had 14 colleges in my list, all of them ENC department. So neither computer science nor electrical or mechanical. Why I'm, you know, trying to focus on this is because, you know, clarity of mind helps you avoid a lot of confusion. And when you are not confused, right, half of the problems won't really arise. So yeah, just of course, to get the clarity, it's kind of, you know, an experimental journey. You'll have to try out different things, but once you get there, it yeah, it's really easy to go forward. So yeah, in first year, actually, I didn't get a seat in NITK right in the beginning. It was a special round, and that was 1 month after the colleges had commenced. So yeah, I was studying.
Sorry to interrupt, Vibhorjan. If you can switch on your camera, that we would be extremely grateful.
Okay. Just give me a second. Is this good? I hope so.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, in the first four rounds or the primary rounds of counseling, I got into VNIT and I studied ENC there for a month or so before I got into NITK. I had basically lost a month of first year. I was like the whole batch, or rather the section, was lagging in that respect. So it was a little difficult, you know, to start off. But you know, things happen. And I'm really grateful, you know, that I got to get into NITK, because had it not been for that special round, I probably wouldn't be talking to you guys, right? First year was very enlightening in the sense that, you know, straight out of the school, you don't know much. I was anyway into electronics. So once I got in, I mean, I had a rough idea as to, you know, what I like. One of the things about first year is, you know, there are too many activities planned by your seniors to make you comfortable and probably even expose you to what all is there in campus. At times there can be some FOMO of, you know, not being able to attend some things, or, you know, that's always the case. It was at least the case with me, because the campus in first year, yeah, it's like bustling with a lot of activities. Meanwhile, I got my Arduino breadboard and all basic electronic components. And yeah, that is the kind of thing I always wanted to do. So I thought, you know, better to start as soon as possible. And yeah, I mean, doing projects on your own is kind of very rewarding in the sense that you get a sense of satisfaction and you also learn a lot of stuff you'd probably not learn in, say, your regular courses, right? So always good to experiment around. Yeah, and then the first big event in the college game, that was engineer. And so a lot of people, you know, they go back to their homes during engineer. I am, you know, grateful that I didn't. And in fact, for the 4 years that I have been in college, I've attended every single event because, yeah, the amount of hard work that people put in and the projects that you see and the events that happened that were, you know, just really too good to miss out. So as a first year, it was very, yeah, I was very amazed by what all was going on. It was kind of an eye-opener as to, I mean, although I knew a bit of electronics, the kind of projects that I was witnessing was a little too impressive, you know, for a first year. So, yeah, that is when I had made my mind to get into this committee called Tech Nights. So that, you know, I should be able to learn how to make those projects and more importantly, build upon that knowledge and, you know, come up with something creative on my own. So, yeah. So first year was usual. Yeah, I mean, again, since we started 1 month late, it was a lot of academic pressure. So couldn't really do much in first semester, I would say. But second semester was chill. So, yeah. Didn't had a lot of technical stuff going around in second semester, I would say. But yeah, incident happened and that was fun. I mean, incident just taught me that it's, you know, it's good to have fun sometimes and blow off some steam so that you are focused and you can handle oncoming pressure a little bit better if there are breaks in between. So yeah, in the summer vacation of first year, I just got home with my electronic components and tinkered a lot. I mean, quite a lot of my time was spent just trying to figure out circuits and trying to recreate what people had done. So yeah, I mean, it was more of a self-learning thing because that was the kind of thing that really felt rewarding for me. And it helped me develop a lot of, you know, hardware, electronic and problem solving skills, which I think, you know, you would only get once you get into an EC lab and, you know, made circuits on your own. So having done that earlier, it gives you a little head start or edge kind of. Second year was interesting. Why? Because that is the first time I got to interact with, you know, peers of my department, the seniors, professors, and yeah, a lot of things were going on. One thing was like, at least EC department was is very chill and really, you know, supportive to the students. We used to have peer mentorship programs from seniors and we even used to get snacks from department. So yeah, it was basically, we had to go to the top, not top, third floor in the department. And yeah, basically an hour of peer mentorship followed by snacks. And that was much better than mess snacks for sure. So it was nice. I mean, you have this family kind of, almost family kind of relation with your seniors and, you know, that really helps out in the long run when you find people who are like so approachable. Yeah, really helps out when you're stuck somewhere. Following that, yeah, I mean, so there are technical clubs like IIT, IEEE, IST, and IE. Forgive me if I'm missing some. But yeah, those things will, yeah, commence usually the beginning of second year, right? And I mean, nothing much there. I got into IEEE. So I wasn't a student member in first year, but the procedure for selection of members is, you know, very fair and everyone gets an equal chance. So irrespective of whether you are a student member or not, it really doesn't matter much. One thing is club interviews, right? They are kind of primer to the interviews you'll be facing or giving in for your, say, internship or placement. So I'd say, you know, take them a little seriously, because the exposure that they give will help you, you know, probably not choke out in internship or placement interviews. I mean, that was quite a large chunk of my third semester. I got to interact with a lot of amazing people from department and IEEE. And around that time, I got into Tech Nights as well. So, yeah, the thing was, from department, you'd find people who are in your domain, right? But it's always good to know people who are, you know, really good in different domains. So Tech Nights was a place where I got to know people who were very good in mechanics and computer science. So, yeah, I mean, really increases the field of view that you have, and you don't get tunnel visioned into your own specific domain. So yeah, Tech Nights was fun. I mean, for a second year, since I knew quite a lot about electronics already, at least the practical part, I used to really enjoy working there. There were sometimes I was even shooed away by the seniors out of the Tech Nights room because it was really late and they had to lock the room. So yeah, again, second year engineer was also fun. I really enjoyed engineer over NC because I was contributing to engineer, but I'm pretty sure a lot of work goes into NC as well. In fact, probably even more. So yeah, I mean, that is one part I didn't really explore. I could have given it a try probably. Yeah. So the problem was, although I was having, a lot of great opportunities of learning, and I did learn, it came at a cost that my academics went for a toss. I got, I think, around 8 point something GPA in the third and even, in fact, in fourth semester, which is partly because I wasn't managing the whole academic performance. I mean, it wasn't that great, as well as, the courses that were there in the second year were a little demanding. So technically, right, they'll found the foundations of all upcoming courses. So they'll be a little bit detailed. And yeah, you have to respect that. I mean, you cannot just study a night before the end sims and expect to get a 9-pointer or something. So yeah, that is a miss from my side, definitely. And I would advise you to take, approach second year a little cautiously, right? And not so casually. Yeah. So club project expos were really nice. Now this is in the fourth semester. And again, since all the clubs will be presenting their projects, you'll get to see a lot of innovation and what all stuff people are working on. So really nice to see work done by others, because that really, if you are working, of course, you'll get a lot more in-depth knowledge of what how things work. But if you review others' work, you'll also get to know a good deal of what goes into making something, right? And it's always advisable to review what others are doing. So then came the summer vacation of second year. Now, this is approximately the time where people would try to look for internship. Even my friends did it at that time. But I tried to get an internship, I would say it wasn't an honest try. I just made a couple of profs probably, and then I just realized that it wasn't really for me. Also, my GPA was bad. So, another point where if you want to go for an internship in at the end of second year, probably keep a decent CGPA. But again, internship after second year is not something really mandatory as such. I mean, it's up to you. But I still wanted to do something for the summer, right? I didn't want it to waste it. I got in touch with the professor who taught us microprocessor then, and he lent me an RPy, and he asked me to implement some audio processing project on that. So yeah, fairly open-ended, I would say. But that is the thing, if you don't have a goal, right, you can mess around with the hardware all you want and probably find something useful. So that is exactly what I did. My summer was basically trying to get some interesting analog project, audio project working on the Raspberry Pi. And that did teach me a lot, because earlier I was, you know, using Arduino, and then, I went on to RPi, and yeah, it really adds to your experience and your toolkit, right? You can use that whenever required. The other thing was, in fourth semester, we had analog electronics course, and I really liked it. I had discussions with my senior, and they said that, if you like analog electronics, probably TI is a good place to be. Because, unlike embedded or digital electronics, right? Analog is kind of, you need to know the industry norms as such to, understand what's going on currently, because the academia is kind of lagging quite a lot compared to industry when it comes to analog. So yeah, I mean, having exposure in industry would be totally different from what you would probably get in academia. So that was why when it was summer of second year, so I was like, let's try to get into TI for internship. Is there a message? Okay, I'll continue. So yeah, third year was third year is when things start to get a little heated up, because everyone is a little bit nervous and kind of anxious because of the whole internship and placement season. Third years would be more worried about the internship. I wanted, as I told, to get into analog, right? So I gave the prelim test for TI and analog to me. And the thing is, right, it's going to be a little hectic because there'll be tests and interviews one after the other. You'll have to do a lot of juggling to manage time. That was also the case with me. Like, I was writing the test for Qualcomm prelim test, and that was when the result for TI came out, and I had cracked the prelim, and I was selected for the interview. So yeah, I just left the Qualcomm test. Again, not advised, but I left it and went back to hostel just kind of to run through my notes and calm myself down for the interview. If you ask me, of course, like, interviews are really dependent on the panel that takes your interview. For example, most of the people in my batch, right, who were interviewed for analog were asked, op-amp questions and RC circuits. Some were probably even asked BJTs or MOSFETs, whatever. I was asked, what is the meaning of my name? That was the first question. Some other questions that followed was related to my projects, like, if you were harvesting energy from a mobile tower, is it stealing energy or is it generating new energy? What is it exactly? So yeah, lot of different questions apart from, I think, one RC question. Most of the questions were, very unique. So I would say, the experience of an interview or technical interview is going to vary on a person-to-person basis. Before I continue, right, I would like to add that internships are for you to get an exposure outside the campus, right? It's not something you would want to lose your sleep over. It's just not going to help. Anxiety is not going to help you crack interviews or you know, perform better. It'll only, you know, worsen your performance and might have bad effects even academically and non-academically. So try to keep cool. I know it can be hectic juggling between lectures and club activities and then internships and yeah. But soon things will calm down. Not for long though. I mean, once the internship or placement season is over, right? There's NG prep going on and then there'll be club activities ramping up too. So yeah, your hands will always be full, except that, you know, not much would be at stake when it comes to college related activities. So yeah, and probably mix some freshers here and there, right? So won't really realize where exactly the semester would end. Yeah, it's going to be really quick. There was a technical interview followed by an HR interview. HR round was, it was just 5 minutes. They really wanted to gauge, why I wanted to get into TIS specifically. So yeah, nothing out of the box there. Really streamlined, and I got selected as an analog intern in TI. So yeah, this internship would be for the summer of 2018. And yeah, I was really happy because once I got into TI, this was like really early in the semester. So I could, you know, focus on club recruitments and tech nights related activities. And yeah, and I'd say that, once you get an internship, it does really bring a certain peace of mind to you, which is really nice, you know, so that you can give 100% to all other things. So yeah, with that, fifth and sixth semester were, you know, really briefs. I took a lot of math courses offered by EC department, and I really enjoyed them because at the heart of a lot of communication related courses, right, it's just plain mathematics, and math is kind of simpler to understand. And once you appreciate what exactly is going on, it's really helpful, right? And even in say communication or signal processing. So yeah, one such course was analog integrated circuits, which it was really nice to take that course. Of course, it was compulsory back then. I think now it's an elective, but that course actually left me in awe with the subject because it was just too good. That was the only course, I think, in which, you know, if a problem statement was given, like as a homework or after class work, I solved it on paper. I went to the lab in my free time, implemented the circuit, verified it, and even went back to the professor with the photos of the waveform to say that, hey, I did this. And I'm really proud of it because, you know, that was when I realized that TI is going to be fun, because AIC was just a subject I enjoyed, through and through. Not bragging, but yeah, I am bragging. But yeah, I got a 50 on 15 NSEMs for AIC, and that was a big deal for me. I mean, you know, there had been subjects where I was, you know, borderline going into 7 and 6. And for a person, you know, who's not really that much into academic performance, getting full on is, yeah, I really am proud of it. So, yeah. I also did some embedded projects meanwhile, because the thing is, once you explore something new, right, you wouldn't want to forget what you've already learned. So in fifth and sixth semester, again, I took up some real-time audio processing projects on STM32 and Arduino, and that kind of, you know, let me have my grip on these subjects. Summer vacations came by, and yeah, it was a new experience because, of course, internship is going to be your first step into how corporate world works, right? You would learn a lot of things. So my internship was in this team called that makes basically transceivers. Transceivers as in These are ICs used for long distance communication using wire, so wired transmission and over long distances. So my mentor was really nice. That was really great. I mean, the team as a whole was really nice and supportive. First couple of days in internship, right, just going into training and explaining how exactly things work in TI, things to do, things not to do, stuff like that. And we also had an interaction with some new college graduates so that, you feel free to ask some questions you find, weird asking otherwise. So that was pretty nice. I had never used any industrial sim tool, right? That way, it was a bit challenging in the beginning, but there was a fellow intern with me who was working under the same mentor. He was from NIT Calicut and he had used the tool, a little bit in his college. So he was really helpful to me. It was fun discussing, our internship projects, because that way we are kind of able to learn double the things, because it's almost as if two people are working on two projects. And so, it's nice to interact with other interns. People in my team were very approachable when it came to, asking doubts and stuff. So all in all, my TI experience was really, really good. I was, I was living with three of my other friends, again, batchmates who had, who were interning in TI. So it was even better of an experience because at the end of the day, we could come and discuss each other's work. And it was nice all in all. So at the end, right, so this was a 9-week internship and I couldn't really do a lot, I would say, on the actual design part, because design takes a lot of effort. I mean, can take up to 4 to 6 months for completing one design. So not a lot of work on the design front, but on the architecture front, I was still able to make some progress. The final presentation was, so I got a lot of inputs from the people already in TI, because at that time there were three super seniors of mine who were in TI, and they gave me really, really valuable input as to how you should present and all those good stuff. Two of them I knew personally as well, so it was, really a breeze to be confident on the final presentation. On the day of the presentation, though, there were like 30 plus people. And I mean, when you are presenting to a huge crowd, right, it's pretty normal to choke. And I choked as well. I mean, there's nothing wrong in that. Just a word of advice, take a water bottle with you when it comes to presentations. It was really surprising that my internship was, scrutinized and taken very seriously. Considering it's an intern's work, right? I wouldn't have expected so many people to, give up their time and probably, even show up. So that was very surprising in a good way later, because it shows that whatever work you have done, right, there's a value attached to it. And that's really nice to know. Last week was mostly documentation of whatever I had done. And basically uploading and backing up all the data so that in future, people can take up that work from there. So around this point, I was getting a little anxious because, TI is known for offering PPOs, and my 9 weeks work was, experience was really good. I had made my mind that I wanted to get in TI as a full-time, right? So my mentor gave me a call a day before my last day in TI, that I had a technical interview in the evening. And the person was not from our team. He was a completely new person, very jovial. And we talked about a lot of general stuff, even asked me, whether I was satisfied with my academic performance. Just give honest answers. That's all that I would say. And following 20 minutes of questions on MOSFETs, he just wished me all the best and just told me that, you know, in case I get a PPI, I'll be informed by the HR. So yeah, the next day, all the formalities were complete, and then HR called me with my CV, and there was a 15-minute HR discussion. He was just trying to understand, you know, what are my long-term goals and aspirations and things like that. So yeah, same. He just wished me, you know, best of luck too, and that was how my internship was. The next day, when I was in the airport, I was in the flight, in fact, and that is when I got the PPO letter on my personal mail ID. And that was, I could have screamed, but since I was in the flight, I decided not to. It was really, you know, lifts a lot of weight off of you, because when it comes to seventh semester, right, placement season is like really, really hectic, and the stress is just real. Now, unlike internships, placements really, you know, or at least on-campus placements, they are responsible for, I would say, at least 80% or so of placements, right? So you'd want to get in through on-campus placements. And yeah, there is a lot of juggling again going on with all the tests and interviews. So again, my advice is try to stay calm. It's hard, I know, but and again, I shouldn't be the one to tell you, right? Because I had already gotten a PPO, so I don't really know what the anxiety is like. But I've seen my friends, you know, running around between tests, and there were times when people were waiting outside the CDC for, you know, like well past midnight, waiting for the results. Which is, not the kind of state you would want to be in, right? So just keep calm. Things will fall in place sooner or later. Also, I would say that there is a little bit of luck and sort of happenstance in placement as well, okay? So although it matters that, you know, you have a firm understanding of basics, but sometimes it's just bad luck. I mean, just shrug it off and, you know, move forward. Don't try to latch on to something or, yeah, someplace you didn't get into. Once the job issue was solved, I mean, I was relieved. So I could, again, you know, give 100% to all the other things. Final year, I got to be the convener of Tech Nights, one of the two conveners, of course. And I was like managing close to like 100 plus people, which is, quite a task. I also was elected as the diode secretary. And the thing is, I had not really taken up any job which involved, you know, people management or coordinating between people. That was not the kind of stuff I was into. I was more into, you know, ground work, and it was challenging for me, sure. I mean, it's not an easy task to manage people. I was still pursuing my non-academic projects, you know, fun projects, along with the major project now. And in seventh and eighth semester, I actually fabricated a lot of PCBs for both kind of projects, because it was quite experienced to, you know, fabricate your own PCBs. And I was not, you know, really concerned about my academic performance anyway. I mean, it was stable. I was getting consistent 9+ some things. But yeah, it was sort of irrelevant, because the damage was already done in my second year. And I also had a job, so I didn't have to worry about it as long as I passed. Eighth semester was very packed because of all the, you know, things happening. There were so many farewells and project expos and incidents and Thanksgiving. And then there was Chaman Day as well, which is, in case you people you don't know, Chaman Day is like a cosplay event in the EC department exclusively. So that was their class trips were their ring ceremony. And oh my God, it was just so damn packed. I mean, there was barely enough time to breathe. So yeah, most of us were always tired, but we were always up for, you know, whatever was there coming up next. Even got a chance to dance in SJ, not once, but twice. in the final semester. And that is something, you know, these are the things that you remember, not really the tension that you went through during placement season. So yeah, summer vacations came by, and yeah, at that time I relaxed. I really relaxed, as in I didn't do any projects. I was just doing, you know, normal stuff like attending functions, hanging out with cousins, those kind of things. And I think everyone should, because that could be the last summer vacations of your life, I mean, for all you know, right? So I just chilled out and then joined TI on 3rd June of 2019. It has been 2 years, and yeah, it's still cliche to say, but still feels like yesterday. Now, I joined the same team in which I interned, so ramp up was very, very quick. This time, however, my work was more centered towards lab, and I had to model cables and things like that. So yeah, really different work from what I had done in internship. And it was interesting, you know, to work on something so diverse. Around beginning of 2020, I started working as a validation engineer for the upcoming project. So the ramp up was very steep, I would say, because you'd have to learn quite a few softwares, and that demands a little bandwidth, I'd say. And the thing is, right, in internships, there's nothing at stake, I mean, apart from the PPO. But in a small team like ours, right, we have barely 28 people. If you miss anything, the stakes are huge. Like, we're talking some $1 million, okay? So yeah, that's the case. Excuse me. Yeah. So that being said, work stress is real. I mean, there will be times, you know, wherein you'll be gating something, and that is when you'll begin to feel the heat. The thing is, it all boils down to your colleagues. I mean, my team was very supportive. There were times when you had to solve something or to do something. And that was when, you know, my team stepped in front of me and took over and, you know, really helped me a lot. And that is what matters, I would say. Also, I did my fair share of mistakes. And the best thing was, you know, I was like always greeted with solutions and fixes to my mistakes. And that was really nice, you know, to never be sort of taken otherwise. People are always there to help you out of if you get into soup, right? So yeah, of course, COVID has changed a lot of things since my work is you know, dominantly lab related. So working from home has been a bit challenging. Had to relearn a lot of things, and now we are almost you know, working normally. I mean, not the way we used to work, but there's no performance impact due to COVID, and that is what I think matters, right? To be able to solve problems given a set of constraints, and if the solution is elegant, right, you feel that you have done something. And I think that is what is job satisfaction, right? So yeah, really nice to have. I've been sharing my place with three of my EC batchmates. It's our home, and it's really easy for me to, or I would say it's really easy for everyone, you know, to start off their career in corporate life, knowing that you can always, you know, go back home, and you'll have your friends waiting there for you. So it's great to have someone to talk to, right? I mean, and especially if it's your batchmate, right? It's just going to be great from the get-go. So yeah. The takeaway is to stick together with your friends and seniors. They'll always help you out. Problems are easy to solve together. That is, I think, all I had about my journey from first year to yeah, where I am today. So it's 6 years and I think, yeah, 40 minutes.
Oh, wow, what an amazing journey it was. It was like a beacon to us to step up the corporate ladder. Thank you so much on behalf of IIT Club for that insightful talk. Now, we have a lot of questions coming from the audience. I now request you to kindly answer them.
Yeah, sure.
Hello. Hello, good evening.
Yes, sir.
Like many of my EC and triple friends want to go for a software company because they believe opportunities and packages are less in core companies. Mm-hmm. Is that just a myth or should it be so true?
So one of the things is right. Don't go behind numbers. If you look at the PPO, the packages that companies offer, right? That is going to be different from the in-hand cash you'll get. Okay, so a lot of companies, right? They'll provide money in terms of their shares, and you can only sell those shares or avail that money after you say. Be in that company for 3 or 5 years, something like that. Okay. So, yeah, I mean, these are details, you'll have to read between the lines to see what exactly is the actual amount that you're getting or what is the amount of interest, quote unquote. That being said, yeah, software companies do sometimes, provide more than core companies. It's just that really depends on whether you want to work and, be passionate about your work, or do you want to make money? I mean, if making money is your passion, then of course go for it. But yeah, really, it's a personal choice. I just didn't want it to go into software, so I chose the TI.
Yeah, hello, my name is Sreena. Like, how important do you feel is Analog Electronics while preparing for the internships and placements?
So again, depends, right? In TI at least, right? They offer you to apply for either analog or digital or software. So there are three domains, right? So you can apply on these three independently of the others. So yeah, if you are applying for analog electronics, of course you'll have to, have your analog electronics dusted really well.
Yeah.
I hope that answers the question. Yeah.
Yeah, it does.
We have a lot of other questions pending. Guy has asked, can a guys with CGPA between 7.5 to 8 make it into the core company like Texas, Qualcomm, if they perform well in the tests and interviews?
So yeah, I mean, CGPA is just like, I don't know how is the convention now, but in 12th standard, you must have a minimum 75%, right? It's like a hard cutoff. So something similar is there for GPA as well. Different companies have different levels. But yeah, I would always suggest, try to keep it between, keep it above 7.5. 7.5 is the gray area where, a company might, not take that. I have seen Samsung take, Samsung's cutoff to be 7.5 consistently. But there are other companies who probably even want, people with more than 8. So, CGPA is just, it lets you overcome that preliminary barrier. You just want to qualify, right? So, keep that up. And I think rest is just on the performance that you have in test and interviews.
Okay, thanks, Lord. Here's one more question. A student has asked, which should I focus more on? On-campus or off-campus internships?
Really depends again. The amount of opportunities that are there in on-campus interviews, right? I mean, internship opportunities, they are really good. In case you don't feel that there are companies who are catering to your particular needs, then probably you would want to look for off-campus opportunities. Though I would advise, right, like don't try to take up an on-campus, don't accept an on-campus interview internship and then later on ditch it for some off-campus thing, because that is basically wasting somebody else's opportunity. So yeah, don't try to do that.
Yeah. Another student is asking, what are the available opportunities for the students who are interested in analog electronics?
Oh, okay. So analog, I mean, I don't know about you, but at least back in my time, right, people were saying that digital is going to dominate. And yeah, it has been 3 years, I mean, or at least 2 years in TI and then. But I don't see that analog is going to die as such. I mean, the opportunities are only increasing with even, say, 5G coming in, right? The amount of research that's going into all these high frequency RF technology, it's just insane. And as long as there is interaction between physical world and the digital world, analog will always be there. So plethora of opportunities in analog, I would say.
Another guy is asking tips for a good resume.
Hey, sorry, Nitin, I lost you there. Could you repeat?
A guy is asking tips for a good resume, like for internships or the placements.
That's a really good question. So one thing I'd recommend is, or at least that I followed is, make it a one pager, okay? It has to be one page, single-sided. Shouldn't go on to the next side even, okay? But the thing is, in internships, right? Yeah, people, so at least folks from companies, right? They come for placements and internship is like sort of side hustle, okay? They don't have a lot of time to give to internships, right? So keep your resumes really crisp and to the point. Don't put in unnecessary details that you came first in nursery or KG1, okay? That's nobody's going to read that for that matter. You can probably start with 12th standard, but even that I feel is unnecessary. Just, you know, have your GPA and like whatever projects you have done. Things that, you know, are of interest to the person. Don't try to write a lot of stuff which is like not really interesting for, because again, this is not a full-timer they're looking for. This is an intern, right? So they don't have a incentive to read through a long resume. Keep it simple, keep it clean, and yeah, keep it crisp. This is all I have to say.
Okay. Here's one more question. As per my understanding, nowadays even in core companies will be working with the simulation software. So then how do you make a choice between core and software companies?
Good. So the thing is, although we are simulating, right, it's not, we are not trying to code a circuit. So in even in the simulation or design software, right, we have to place the MOSFETs and connect the resistors, capacitors, everything in logical manner, and then do hand calculations even, you know, to find what is the performance going to be. So I wouldn't call it coding, or, you know, even if you are simulating, it's nowhere close to software coding. No, not at all. So it is still very much, you know, in the true spirit of electronics, I would say.
If the other guys who are in the meet, if you guys have any doubt, you can ask.
Any suggestions for internship preparation?
Again, depends on what your domain is going to be. If it's going to be digital, it'll be a different set of things you would want to focus on. At least for analog, right? I would say that just prepare whatever has been taught to you, like whatever has been the coursework, because companies usually don't expect a lot from second year person or like who has just gotten into third year. So don't try to go full blown into, say, BGTs or things like that. Try to keep your basics really strong. As long as the basics are strong, I mean, that is what the companies are looking for. You should be able to crack any interview. So yeah, I mean, I don't know what exactly is the course coverage for you guys, but at least for me, it was just three things: RC circuits, MOSFETs, and op amps. These three things would, yeah, get you through, or at least help me get through into UTI. So, yeah.
Like, can you please suggest any like website or book for studying RL circuits, like RLC circuits and all?
Yeah. So, okay. I would suggest that, if you want to get into the theory, probably take up analog books. For example, Sidran Smith is a good place, I mean, for MOSFETs. And in fact, it has almost practically everything. So that is one. If you want to solve problems, probably go for gate kind of websites, which have very targeted problems for, say, interviews or say preliminary test. If you want to get into those kind of problems, probably, yeah, that is going to be a good place to start. The other thing is you will find question papers for whatever preliminary tests had been conducted earlier, right? So try to dig those out. At least those are something I found, or at least our seniors shared with us a day before the actual test. So that was also kind of nice. Gives you the feel of what kind of questions to expect.
What a wonderful afternoon it has been. It was great listening to you and learning from you, dear Vibhor. Thank you so much for taking the time and sharing your experiences with all of us. It was very informative and thought-provoking. I, on behalf of IIT NITK, would like to thank Mr. Vibhor Jain for being with us this afternoon. Thank you, Vibhor. Further, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to all the students present in the meet. You are all a wonderful audience for the day. Thank you so much, one and all. Ending this wonderful learning session on a positive note, Nahi Jnaneya Sadrisham, which means knowledge alone triumphs. Now, we are delighted to have one more speaker, Mr. Rohan, for another session today at 4 p.m.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I hope it's audible for everyone. So, can I start?
Just a minute.
Yes.
Yeah, fine.
So, good afternoon, everyone. I am Saurabh Gole from third year EC department. Heartily welcome to IIT Speaker Series. To start with, I would like to thank Mr. Rohan Katkam, our second speaker, for taking some time out of his busy schedule and joining with us today. So Rohan is currently pursuing his master's in embedded systems at TU Delft, Netherlands. He is an NITK alumnus and was part of IIT club as a publicity coordinator and head of Rohit Singh. Mr. Rohan, we are very excited to listen about your journey from NITK to TU Delft and your experience with NITK. So, over to Rohan, Mr. Rohan.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Saurabh. And hey, guys, I hope you all are doing good. My name is Rohan. And yeah, as Saurabh has mentioned, I'm doing master's here in TU Delft. So I'll begin with my experience in NITK and why I chose NITK. So back in college, back in school, I was looking for universities and like most of my friends were going for in CS or I think mechanical. I didn't want to join the hype train. So I thought let's go for electronics. And it seems interesting. I found the electronics part in the NCRT book to be quite interesting and the communications part. So yeah, I felt I might as well go for ECE in NITK. The first year was very relaxed and it was an exploratory stage because we come from school and we experience different things like activities and like different timings, like after like course timings are different, and after that you have a lot of free time during the day, so you feel more relaxed. And that's when the girls block night canteen had egg biryani, and that was really cheap, so that was good times. The subjects were common, so that was one big factor. So we all used to discuss and discuss how our exams went, how bad our exams were. And the preparation for first year exams was much better than I would say second, third or fourth year, because we used to prepare like maybe 2-3 days before or a week before. We are very excited about this course as well. Well, not for all of them, but yeah, some courses were pretty fun. And yeah, as also Vibhor mentioned, there is quite a bit of stuff to do when you're in first year. Like there's incident, there's engineer, there is dance competitions, there's art competitions, and there are a lot of stuff you can participate. And for me, at the end of first year, when we had summer holidays, I joined this thing called IET mentorship program, which was in the summer. I also bought some electronics, so the Arduino kit for this thing, and it was very fun and interesting. So the mentor was really insightful. He gave explanation of how microprocessors work, what kind of language do you use, and how do you build circuits, and how do you write a code to interact with the circuit. So I found it really interesting, and how you can merge software and hardware together. So also since I didn't have all the electronics for the homework that they gave for mentorship program, I used some simulation circuits. So that was one interesting thing. So even if you're back home and if you don't have electronic circuits, you can still simulate them online. You find some online websites for it, and that's pretty interesting as well. Yeah, so that was my first year. Like, it was fun. Second year was pretty hectic. It was because, as again Vibhor mentioned, the courses were fundamental, like control system, like analog electronics, digital electronics, even communications. It was electromagnetism and other like subjects, and even maths, linear algebra, probability. So there were a lot of subjects in a very short amount of time, and they were all fundamental. So you had to put in a lot of effort and hours to study all these subjects. And for me, it was quite difficult. I didn't put in enough effort to understand these things, and I studied in the last minute, which I do not recommend anyone to do that. However, when during, I think in the third semester, like there was a publicity event in the boys block, and they wanted some students for electronic projects in during engineering. So Technites and Tronics is what they are. I joined Tronics, and like it was a very like interesting committee. Like I met a lot of seniors, and a lot of my batchmates were really talented and motivated. Some of my electro EC seniors, including Vibhor, I would say they're pretty put their heart and soul for like to make circuits and to make these things work. So for engineer, we had these exhibits and competitions, and the behind the scenes was I was part of it. So I saw how much effort people put in making, let's say, like some piano stairs or making some musical benches. So it seems simple, but it was like circuits were hard to debug, or sometimes it didn't work in between. So all these things I got to know, and that was pretty, it paid off, to be honest. And so I recommend you guys to take part in these committees and projects. You get to learn as a learning experience, but also you also put effort, so it's like mutual experience. And with IET, I joined IET back in second year, and also did some workshops there, and didn't work much on the projects, but also there was another summer mentorship program which I myself mentored. So that was again fun. I mentored on microprocessors and basic electronics as well. So like the participants were very enthusiastic as well. So I hope they enjoyed it. So second year was I would say more of me participating in different things and not focusing on academics. But that costed my grades to fall down quite a lot. So now moving to, so back in second year, I thought my grades were low, thought I'll probably explore further and see what other people work on and what other projects are out there. So I thought of going for an internship. In this case, I happened to talk to a professor in the university, and he suggested me to join a startup in Bangalore. It's called FluxGen. And over there, I got to know how like startup kind of floats, because I think the startup culture is very competitive in Bangalore. And more than the work, I think we hang out a lot. We go for chai or go for snacks in the roadside, and that was fun. And also there were a lot of programs, charity work, a program and stuff. So I think that was two or three of them. And you get to also participate in these startup events and stuff like that. So it was a good experience. And I worked on something called fog computing, and that was a little different. That was more of a networking thing, wasn't something EC specific, I think. It was in essential how I send the data. Instead of sending to the cloud, I can send to another device that can process some of the data, and it can store the results in the cloud. So there was some electronics I used for this purpose, but as a whole, it was a good experience. And during this time in third year, I found courses to be a bit more comfortable. We had courses for different subjects, like radar sounds fun, but actually it was pretty interesting. System design, so working on FPGAs and stuff. Even mathematical subjects like dynamical systems in chaos, something which is very different from your core electronic subjects. There was controls which I really didn't like. It's pretty tough in to be honest. And around that time, the placement session was going on, and not placement, sorry, the internship session. And a lot of my friends, I was thinking of applying to the companies that were coming in for internships. I did apply for TI, but in back of my mind, I thought I wanted to do something which is like a research based or something like a project based research internship. So I felt that maybe interning in a company would not be a thing for me. Thought like my grades are low, so would be very I don't think I might be getting selected for the internships and stuff. So I thought of going for research internships in universities or abroad. In India, it's pretty competitive. If you want to go for an internship in, let's say, IITs or IISc, they look at your grade. So I didn't have a good grade, so that I couldn't get selected for that. So what I tried was mailing professors. That is one approach of getting to know if they have any positions for internships or if they're looking for any students in the lab. So you can mail professors in IITs and IISc. If sometimes they give a reply, sometimes they do not, but don't be sad about it. If you really like the project, you can still mail and find out. When you're looking for internships in universities, you should always check the projects that they do or what field do they work on, even if you don't know about the projects. So if you're really interested, don't just hesitate. Don't sit back and think, I won't get any milega, that's going to be tough. Just apply. You can put your interest, show your effort, on if you want to go for it. So continuing this quest, I found out there's something called IAST. It's a student organization. It has a research like internships abroad. So it has an office in Manipal. I think they're still doing work from home based internships, so you can check that out. And they are technical internships. They have internships for different fields, like not only computer science, electronics, but like I think mechanical engineering, robotics, and etc. Apply to IAEST, and the recruitment process is not the same as for internship one. In internship process for in NIT case, so the companies come, they do technical round, you have to do some MCQs or fill out some answers, and then they select you for interviews. They sometimes also do GD or group discussions and do technical rounds and then do HR round. But for this one, it's a little different. It's they ask you to submit your extracurricular achievements or like your grades and your experience, like a motivation letter, let's say. And so they see all this and then they select you on basis of that. And they also do an interview in the end. It could be HR or technical interview, but it's more relaxed. For me, I got an internship in Czech Republic. It was working on like a sky camera. Like it takes the pictures of the sky and tries to predict the weather, like weather tracking. So my work was to compress these images, and because the device that they're using, it's a Raspberry Pi, which was connected to the camera, and the data storage was kind of an issue for them. So they wanted to see in what ways they can compress the images and whether they can send the images back to their office or other options. So I was working on that. So that was my internship in third year. Moving on to the also, yeah, in IET we had some interesting club projects in the SIG. So that was fun. We worked on the detection system for blind people. Wanted to use some ultrasonic sensors and see if the person collides with something, or you know how we can send an SOS signal to that after collision. So it was a fun, simple project, but yeah, it was quite fun. And yeah, take part in projects, and it would be quite rewarding. And final year, I approached a professor who happens to look for projects in embedded systems, like in robotics based in IAC. So I know a professor who knows a professor looking for these projects. So like that's how it went. I also mailed him as well, just to understand what he's looking for. Did my final year project in IAC. So I wasn't in the university in NITK back then. I missed some of the fun events and even engineer for that matter. So that was the downside, but like on the brighter side, I did go to the project was really good in IAC. So we worked on robotics, we made some robots, we wanted to see how it can be used in an industrial system. So we got to learn something pretty different, like kinematics and dynamics, which is not there in EC. There was electronics, there was soldering of boards, there's PCB design, and even you'll get to learn what kind of motors do you need for your robot, what kind of material do you need, the chassis. So it's something more practical. So that is something in NITK, I'm not sure if you would get an experience, this is a good plus point of doing internship outside NITK or a research, like a final year project, is that you can see different fields combining together, and also depends on your project as well. So yeah, during that time I thought of going for applying for masters, because I didn't sit for placements. I was little anxious about going for placements, and I wasn't looking forward to placements, because I think ever since in college I thought I'll probably study like more, get to more experience on different subjects. Never went in depth into a particular subject, I think. So looking that, I thought I will apply for masters. So first step for applying for a masters, what I did was to which countries I wanted to go for. So since I was biased with Europe, and Europe has good places to travel, I thought of applying to European universities as well as US. USA has a lot of job opportunities and a lot of projects and companies. So it's another different set of universities US has. So I made a tentative list of universities. It's not final list of universities, but I know I kind of wanted to see my list, how it is. So in the list, you have some safe universities, some moderate, and some tough universities. So safe ones are those where you think your grades and your experience, your GRE scores are enough for getting an application to this university. And also some online, there are some online websites, this one called Yocket, where you see other people's experience and their what was their grades, or how was their experience, and how was their GRE scores when they got an acceptance from that university. So I saw that. I also looked into the cost of living in that country, and the job opportunities, which is really important, because in general for masters or anyone going for masters, you take a loan, and that is quite a large sum of money. So you need to see how you try to repay back. And for that, job is kind of important. Job or a PhD. So in Europe, a PhD is considered as a job. So you get paid like a person who would get paid in a company. So that is a plus point. Not sure in the US, but you get paid no matter what, in which country, as a PhD student. So yeah, embedded systems in that matter has a good market in Europe and in the US. There are a lot of startups. So embedded systems in a nutshell doesn't only mean that it's only combination of hardware and software, so some microcontrollers and stuff. Embedded is a broad field. It can be in control systems, let's say robotics areas. It can be only programming, like programming, embedded programming is what we call here, and also in only hardware, like FPGAs and programming on that. So that's system design aspect. And there's also communications, where you can, there's IoT, Wi-Fi, like 5G and other stuff. So it's a broad field, embedded system. So even if you're in a computer science student, you can still apply for embedded system. Or even if you're electrical, for that matter, I have a senior who is doing embedded systems, he did electrical in NITK. So how he got is through control systems. So they have a lot of control-based courses in electrical in NITK. So that's how he got into QDelv. So yeah, so during my final year project, I was preparing for GRE and TOEFL. So you see which universities need GRE, which universities need TOEFL. So I would do not recommend anyone to go for coaching or consultancy for test preparation, because one, it's expensive, and two, you can do it yourself. You can look at websites online, you can download some books, and you can also buy GRE books. And there are some apps which you can use to prepare for GRE or TOEFL. So that is how a process is. So the first thing is you select some university. Second thing is you prepare for GRE. And the third thing is you approach your professors or your manager, internship manager, for asking them for a letter of recommendation. So universities ask you to submit something called letter of recommendation, which professors do that. So professors send a letter of how you worked under him or her. So he has done so and so things, and I really recommend him for so and so field or project. So that is letter of recommendation, and many universities want that. And the fourth thing is something called letter of motivation or a statement of purpose. So yeah, it's you explain like your experience, like how I'm explaining right now, in the form of a passage, like I think 1500 words or 1000 words or even 500 words. So that depends on the university. You explain of your experience in internship, your coursework, your motivation to why did you apply to this university, and other questions you answer them. And yeah, don't write stories like, you know, the moment I was born, I started programming motherboard and stuff. So they don't look at all that stuff in the letter of statement of purpose. And when you're all this time, when you're selecting universities, you also don't look at rankings. Rankings is quite deceiving, because rankings looks at different programs and departments, and they clubs into one ranking. So maybe electrical is good here or aerospace is really good, but for you, you're going for embedded systems or electronics and stuff. So you look at the department, you look at the projects that they do, you look at professor's field of interest. So let's say a professor can work in wireless communications and machine learning and millimeter waves or like different areas of work. So each professor does not know everything. They focused on few things, and the people who are selecting you in universities, they will like you if you write about these interests in your letter of motivation. Explain that which projects you like in this department and which professor you think you would like to work under in the future. Yeah, so that is one. And the fifth part is resume. The resume is little different than a company resume. A little bit more technical. I'm sorry about that. You need to mention what courses are relevant in from your NITK. You mention your internships. Little more technical, but don't just unnecessarily explain everything. So yeah, that's how you explain. And the rest of the things are more or less similar to a company resume, but yeah. You need to explain your GPA, and you need to mention your GPA and mention your relevant courses, as I said, and your internships and your technical skills as well. So after all this, I got selected for TU Delft and Arizona State University. I went ahead with TU Delft Netherlands because I read about it, and Netherlands has a pretty good job market, and it's less competitive than USA, because in USA, a lot of Indians and Chinese students who are looking for a huge job market in our field as well, in embedded software or hardware. So it's little competitive in US, I think I would say. In Netherlands, the system is quite different. You have in NITK, what you have like semester one, semester two in a year, right? In Netherlands, you have four quarters, so each semester is divided into two quarters, so you have four quarters in a year, and master's is for 2 year program. And I got selected in embedded systems, and we have three specializations in the master's program. You can select any one specialization. So one is software and networking, which I'm currently doing. Then you have only computer organization, which is hardware, FPGA, machine learning for hardware and system design and processor design, like those courses. Third one is called control systems, and that is more oriented toward control systems for robotics or embedded systems, and that is pretty difficult. Control system courses are really difficult and gets very mathematical. So these are the three options, and I went ahead with software. The course plan is very different from NITK. like in general for masters, in US or in Netherlands, the courses don't have, let's say, quiz, mid-sem or end-sem. It really depends on the course. You can have only projects-based courses. So you can, for me, last quarter, I had a course called Embedded Systems Lab. So we had to make a quadcopter that is only project-based. Our evaluation was only to show how the quadcopter flies and stuff. It can also be very theoretical. We had a course called Networking, and that was only exam-based. That was 100% exam. There is no mid-sem, there is no quiz. So it only depends on the courses. And the credit system is also different from NITK. It's you have 4 credits for EC or 3 credits or 2 credit based electives or courses. But here, for my program, they're mostly courses with 5 credits, and each credit has 28 hours of effort. So they take credit system really seriously. No matter whether you're in US or any other country, the credit system is taken very seriously. And that's why their rankings are very good. The international universities, they take these things seriously. They expect you to put in that much amount of effort, no more, no less. Sometimes it goes more, but they expect on average to put that much effort. And also they expect you to put effort in your assignments and submitting them on time. So they time the assignment such a way that you have enough time to do your assignments. Assignments are sometimes in group. You can do in 2 or 3, and also yourself. Plagiarism, or just don't copy paste your answers. So that is taken really strict here in Netherlands and in US as well. So you can be thrown out of the university or country. So just don't copy someone's code. You first understand the concepts and then try to apply. You can always look at online explanation for the code, but just don't blindly copy the code. So that's a big no-no. And one important thing for if you're going abroad is finances. And as I said before, you take loans. So one, I think my recommendation, it's my personal opinion, is to do a job first and then do masters. First thing is that when you suddenly come out of bachelor's to some new environment in masters, you will be you'll be exposed to very stressful environment, and you'll see a lot of people who have very good interests and they're very talented people. And for us Indians, I've seen most of my friends, they worked in Qualcomm or different companies and they came here. For them it was little less challenging, because when you work in a company, you will face deadlines, you will face how you interact with people, how you confront with them, how you do group work. So all that, I wouldn't say non-academic, but it is essential for your life and for if you want to do masters. So I would suggest you to do work for 1 or 2 years or even 3 years, and then you can do masters abroad. And stress is a big factor here. Like, I think even for people who work or for people who study, like, it's different from, you know, chilling in college. Like, you need to manage, have a good work-life balance. And yeah, don't take stress. Like, take a break and go for a jog or a walk. So yeah, also when it comes to courses, the professors here are not like NITK. They're not like super strict, or so there are chill profs in NITK as well, but here everyone is, they take you seriously as well. They understand that you have stress, you have a lot of, you know, courses, coursework. So you can talk to them, you can mail them, you can ask them doubts. Even the TA, the teaching assistant, are helpful. And if you have any questions, if you don't understand anything, just ask them. So that is one, I think for me, it's a shock, but yeah, they're very chill about it. You can, I mean, come for a beer if you ask. So they're pretty chill about it. During COVID, the online lectures, which I think even you guys are having, and even I had for masters for some quarter, is it's pretty not a very good experience. But for me, we have a lot of software based courses and like theory based courses. We don't have labs as such, so online was okay, like manageable for me. But for others who had labs from other departments like civil or maybe aerospace or others, So it was online learning was not a good experience for them. But now it seems that most of the universities are going offline. They're having on-campus lectures. Don't know about India, but abroad, yeah, it's happening soon. And fingers crossed you guys will have a good master's life if you get master's, if you go for master's. Summarizing my experience in NITK, like the hard aspects was for me just to maintain a good grade. Yeah, so don't lazy around, like put some effort, also chill, like, but that balance was for me a little bit difficult in NITK and in Netherlands right now. Also don't be anxious about like placement preparation stuff, just prepare things, like even for interviews and stuff, just get an experience. Even if it was a bad experience, you will still know okay, that's how we talk to people, that's how you answer questions. So just don't ignore the placement, like interviews, go for it, like apply whatever you like. That's one key point. Also, one thing I realized here in masters is that it's not about how much knowledge you know, it's about how much effort you put in. Even if you don't know things, if you're ready to put in the effort, you trust me, you will getting a very good grade here. It's not that he's smart, he's super smart. That is okay, that can be partly right, but put in a lot of effort, talk to your friends, talk to your program people, ask them doubts, discuss with them, be more proactive is the advice, I guess. Yeah, also don't really think too much about your financial problems. You took a loan, you came here to study, focus on, you know, having chill time, but also study, and you will get a job eventually, trust me. And then you can manage your finances well. But yeah, don't just spend unnecessarily, is what I would say. And yeah, I think that's it from my experience so far, from college to masters. Yeah, I spoke a lot, but yeah.
That was a very inspiring journey, Mr. Ron. If anyone from audience want to ask me questions, please go ahead.
How research interns are helpful in going for MS?
So in research internships, you will work with a professor or a lab or in a group. So you will be focusing on, let's say, a particular project, and you will work on one part of it. So in that terms, you will get some experience on like a particular aspect. And I'm not sure, I don't have any like corporate experience. So, but in terms of academia, this is how they do. They do some projects, they get some good results, sometimes even publish papers. But yeah, it's that's how it is for research internships.
All right. Hi, Rohan. How are you? This is Vishwa.
Hi, Vishwa. How are you? I'm good. I'm good.
Yeah, so I wanted to know, like, you know, usually the research internships are 2 months, 3 months, right? And you were talking about doing your final year project at IISc, if I'm not wrong. Is that possible to actually do your final year project under some external guide?
It is possible. It depends on your branch in NITK as well, department in NITK. I'm not sure if civil or mechanical or like these branches allow for a research like final year projects outside NITK, but in EC you can do. They let you do projects outside NITK or even abroad for that matter, like possible to do.
Yeah,
so that will be for a period of 5 months, 6 months. So
a lot of people talk that, you know, publications are really important, and you know, because most of time we get like 2-3 months with any internship, so getting a publication in isn't really possible or, you know, feasible then. So like, how do you make the most of that research internship? Like, how do you make it count while you're applying for any university?
It's not mandatory to, you know, publish a paper. It's a plus point, and you will like maybe have a higher chance in getting accepted into a university. But if you like do the project well, if you are in good terms with your mentor or your professor, he can give you a good letter of recommendation, and you can also explain your experience, your internship experience, like properly in the letter of motivation. I think then they can see that, okay, you have worked in this area, and you can try to convince the in letter of motivation that saying, I have dabbled across this field of work and I would like to know more about it. It's not that you stop here. So I'd be grateful if I get a master's opportunity in your university. Like you frame it in that way, kind of market well, I guess. But yeah, it probably work well, I guess, in the internship.
Yeah, great. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, so I have a question here.
Yes.
How good are my chances to get landed in a core company if I do my MTech in one of the top 7 IITs or top 3 NITs? And is it really worth pursuing MTech after a BTech degree in NITK?
I personally, from what I hear, but not a professional here, but MTech in India, MTech is a little like different from I think abroad, because it's not very strict. Like if you do MS abroad, you will have something. Yeah, put in money, I put in a lot of effort to come here and study. So that factor in India is a little more relaxed, I would say. Although you prepare for GATE, you prepare for interviews, but MTech in few universities are okay, like IIT or like IISc. So depend on the program. First of all, depend on the field of work as well. So you should also see what you're interested in MTech, like see about the professor, whether he has a good like experience and things like that. You can see them on Google Scholar, or you can read about his profile in his web page, in the university page. So different factors, but abroad MS is much MTech or MS abroad is much more for me to personally valuable than doing an MTech in NITK or IITs, let's say. How likely are you to get it depends on your. For India, you need to prepare for GATE. You write a GATE, get I think rankings based on your MTech program. Then you have interview process, and for that you need to prepare more for your subject and your area of work, and the interview is very difficult as what I hear for IITs or IISCs, and that's how you get through for MTech in India. Yeah,
thank you.
No problem.
Okay, so we have some questions here lined up here. So one of them is asking what options are available to do MS for EC people.
What options are there? So for masters, there are a lot of options. EC is a broad field. Like there is, for if I start with electronics, you have analog electronics. So I think US is more of analog research than here in Europe, but again, I haven't looked into that. There is analog electronics. There's again work on machine learning and signal processing. So signal processing is a huge like area of work in Europe and in US. So a lot of universities work on the signal processing here also in TUDEL. So there's signal processing. So machine learning is also coming in signal processing. Like so, it's like a two-in-one thing. And there is control systems, that's what I talked about. So control system is more for robotics oriented field. So robotics is also one thing. So if you're a good experience or you like coding and hardware for like robotics, you can go for robotics, but they would prefer mechanical engineering students over you because they have experience and they have courses in dynamics, kinematics and control. So all the maths that you need for robotics is there in mechanical and not in EC. So that is one downside. There is software programming as well. So if software programming, or let's say embedded programming, so you will learn to code directly on the registers. You will learn to code on microcontrollers, and yeah, this is a resource constrained programming. This is a little different from the normal, let's say, web development or other app development based thing. So embedded programming is there. So this will come under embedded systems. So this is embedded systems wala, systems based master's opportunity. Then there is mathematics, to be honest. That maths is more oriented towards probability and statistics for machine learning, let's say, or AI. So you have in ECE, we have some courses that can give you opportunities to do that. But yeah, that is more of software oriented side. Then you have communications, which is again very broad. So communications has millimeter wave research work. There's radar, which is again signal processing, and a lot of communication concepts, antenna theory. So that's a very, very deep subjects. So there is IoT and mobile networks. So which is what I am interested in planning to think about for my thesis work. So that is a combination of, I think, software and also a lot of communication concepts. And this is what I remember at the top of my head. There are a lot of opportunities. Yeah.
Okay. Another student is asking, is research a good option after graduating, or is it better to go for a job?
Looking at the current scenario, if you're financially well off to do a master's, you can do a master's. However, or if you get a scholarship, that is if you're really interested to do research, if you're really interested to work under a professor, do post grad or do PhD after master's, I would say you can go for it. Although I think for getting scholarships, they expect you to have a very good grade, like not like 8.5, 8.7, but like 9+, I think, is many universities look for. So scholarship, for that you need to have a good grade. And for getting a doing a job and then master's, that is also a very good option. Like I said before, you get good experience, like an overall experience working with different people, and you also putting effort in, you know, doing some projects is also a plus point. However, they also expect you to have some sort of relevant experience. So if, say, you're going for a let's say a totally different master's program, but you only worked on app development, so that is not a relevant experience, so to say. So think, probably work on some relevant projects in company as well. But yeah, it is also a good option to do master's outside, work first and then do master's outside. So in this current situation, yeah, I think I would go for work probably.
Okay, so another is asking, can you share some best and worst moment in NITK?
For me, best moments, yeah, a lot of fun times in NITK. Yeah, we used to play cricket and the dart board back in third year in our wing. So I would say that was fun. Tronix was very fun. Like Tronix, I got to learn a lot of people and the work that they do and the projects as well in Tronix. So that was fun. And I really liked... I know my academics were not great, but I really liked labs in EC, the communication labs, or like the analog digital electronics labs. So they were quite fun, to be honest. Worst moments, I think my I messed up a lot of my grades, and that wasn't a good experience, like in second year, like nearly failed or like that kind of stuff. and yeah, I had a lot of anxiousness in doing different things in college, so I was very worried. So yeah, I didn't like that part. You know, wanted to take part in drama or like, let's say, music, but then I didn't go because I was very worried. So yeah, that was bad things.
So another student is asking, give some tips on preparation for interview and internship.
Interview and internship. So yeah. For like, so yeah, also depends on the company as well. So in general, how you prepare is, yeah, you prepare your concepts well. You prepare your, if you're looking for coding jobs, you do some coding exercise on Geeks for Geeks or look at the concepts on Geeks for Geeks, tutorials point. So there are a lot of websites that give you, guide you some for some preparation. So I think even Vibhor mentioned some gate-based questions is what also good approach is. That is one way to prepare. And yeah, just be confident, honestly. Also, when you're going for HR rounds, be more confident. Show that you're interested in working for that company. Don't mention about doing masters because they, I don't know, for some reason they're very skeptical about you taking in. They don't want you, they want people who want to do masters after job, I guess. I don't know why, but yeah, so don't mention about masters when you're doing interviews. I think in online situation, yeah, you might be more maybe nervous or anxious. Don't worry, like just participate in interviews, like give as many interviews as you can, honestly. Like you will get a good idea. And yeah, when you're selected, yeah, just go for it. Like you don't have to prepare anything as such. I think they'll give you some preparation and stuff when you join the company, and even research internship for that matter. So yeah, show your interest and be confident, I guess.
Okay, so that's all for the question, Q&A question. And once again, thank you, Rohan, on behalf of IIT and ATK for being with us today. We have learned many things from you, and these will be definitely very helpful to everyone in achieving their dream goals. So with that, we have arrived at the end of today's event.
Thank you
very much, everyone, for joining and making this event successful.